Hey Alejandro, do you know what really gets me into the fall spirit?
I don't know, cozying up with a good book or a Halloween movie maybe?
Nope, when I fall into bed after studying for my midterms.
Well, unlike you, I actually love the decorations and festivities that come with the fall season.
Anyways, we are happy to start off the fall season, Broncos. Let's get back to the show. I'm Diana.
And I'm Alejandro, and welcome to episode 3 of
PolyPost Now. Starting off this week's headline recap, student parents are receiving priority registration next semester and will no longer have to worry about not getting into a course they need.
Spooky season is creeping up on us with the top spooky spots on campus.
A possible mask mandate is coming back to CPP after a shocking increase in illness around campus due to COVID-19.
And last but not least, CPP reveals its rose float theme for the upcoming Tournament of Roses Parade.
CPP student parents are receiving priority registration starting January after Assembly Bill 2A1 went into effect. This bill will allow any student with dependents 18 or younger to pick up courses they need to graduate on time while staying on top of their responsibilities as a parent. Who says school has to be hard for parents?
Walking alone after class is spooky enough, especially after class in an old building. And with CPP's rich history, there are a number of spooky places around campus if you want to get your spook on this Halloween season. And you can check out our website for more insight on the spooky shenanigans.
CPP's California Faculty Association is planning on organizing a faculty strike to fight for a higher salary for our professors that work hard to ensure high quality education for all of us. And Victoria is here to tell us more.
Hey Broncos, I'm Victoria Mejicanos, a reporter for the Poly Post. Students may have noticed messages in their syllabi stating the possibility of a faculty strike. Today, we're talking to students and faculty to see what it's all about. Students may believe that professors live a lavish lifestyle, but Dr. Sunny Lee explained that this is far from accurate.
I don't know the links directly, but you all have the resources to find out how much we make, because we're basically public employees. Mm-hmm. You can find out what Coley makes too, You know, Transparent California. Yeah. We're all public employees, so look at that. We're not wealthy, especially in social sciences. We're definitely undervalued. I make around $90,000 a year, but that's like gross income. And if you do like the calculations, taxes, parking, because we have to pay for parking, you know, like one of the only few workplaces where they charge you for parking, for working here, right? It comes down to maybe like $65,000. And so no, we don't make that much money.
Dr. Sunny Lee explained that the CSU has a tendency to separate students and faculty, but she stated that faculty success is student success. Additionally, many members of the CFA believe that there's not a lack of funds, but a misallocation of them.
So since 2019, as far as our general salary increases, the increases that are designed to keep us up with inflation has been 7%, mm-hmm. Whereas inflation's been 20-25%. And you can see this since 2019, for instance, presidents have gotten 20 up to 29 or more percent raises, and you know, up to $100,000 raises. They've also increased the chancellor's salary. So now I think it's something above $700,000, but between their car allowance, their housing allowance, their total compensation is $980,000 a year. So they're not signaling in any way the kind of poverty they tell us they have. Mm-hmm. And so we demand raises that are commensurate with inflation. And we argue, and this will be determined in upcoming fact finding, that they're sitting on, I've heard different estimates, 7 to 8+ billion in assets. Mm-hmm. So that's like them saying they're poor while they have several summer homes. Sure. And so our attitude is that show us that you didn't need to do that. Show us you didn't need to sell the summer home. This mm-hmm. money you've been hoarding, right? Mm-hmm. Demonstrate that just before you raise tuition, which didn't happen, which was why we were out vocally supporting students at the Board of Trustees.
Last semester, I believe the California Faculty Association at Cal Poly Pomona came out to support the Bronco YDSA and students who were trying to get undergraduate student workers organized. And now it's time that we help them out and we support them in their strife.
If students would like to know more about this issue, much of this information is publicly available. You can see faculty salaries, administrative salaries, and even elements of the CSU's budget and how it's being used.
Halloween is a day full of costumes and props. But there are certain things to keep in mind if you're planning on wearing costumes to school this year to ensure students and faculty safety. And here's Marline to tell us more about what to avoid wearing to school on Halloween.
Hi, I'm Marline. With Halloween around the corner, these are some helpful reminders of what to avoid on Halloween. Masks are welcome unless they obstruct your gorish looks. When choosing a costume, make sure not to scare away our community by choosing a cultural costume, such as this one or this one. Refrain from wearing any gorish costumes as well as bringing any accessories that may trigger any individuals, such as knives, guns, and other weapons. Looking forward to seeing your gorish looks on Halloween. Now back to the anchors.
CPP intends to follow CDC and LA County guidelines to not reinforce the mask mandate despite the rising number of students getting sick on campus recently. Although masks are still recommended indoors when needed, no new mandates will be enforced at the moment. Remember to wash your hands and stay safe, Broncos. Wow, I'm starting to think maybe there is more to fall than just me falling into my bed every day.
That's the spirit. You're warming up to the season already. Maybe we can go to the next one together.
I'm totally down. But first, let's head to Alex, Joseph, and Jose to see what others thought about the Pomona Pumpkin Festival.
As October approaches, many students, staff, and other members of the Pomona community get ready for a month full of Halloween-themed activities. The Don B. Huntley College of Agriculture hosted its second annual Cal Poly Pomona Pumpkin Fest Preview Night on Friday, September 29. The Pumpkin Preview Night event took place from 5 to 8:30 p.m., welcoming guests 21 years and over to enjoy food tasting, live entertainment, fun activities, and award-winning beer and wine. More than 20 vendors participated in the event, which included a variety of well-known local restaurants such as Native Fields, Dragon Fire Barbecue, and Tom's Tailgate. Lanny Fox, the owner of Rosemello Artisanal, mentioned that her gourmet marshmallows are made with fresh ingredients grown at CPP.
I make these very special artisanal confections. There's nothing that exists in the food market like them. They're what I call beyond scratch because I grow and make everything for them. Tonight I actually use Cal Poly produce for them. And usually what I do is I talk to Cal Poly and the farm store about what produce they want to highlight. This is my second year doing this. And then I work in collaboration with them to, since they're so produce forward desserts, I work with them to try to like show different ways that Cal Poly produce can be used.
Guests also enjoyed a variety of fun activities, which included a petting farm, corn maze, duck racing, and lots of photo opportunities. In addition, the Storytellers, a progressive bluegrass band, provided live music to all guests as they danced the night away, enjoying their food and drinks. Emily Howe and Kyle Kunaroktai, who were attending the preview night for the first time, shared what they enjoyed about the event.
Definitely, like, all the wine and the beer tastes amazing, but also the petting zoo. That was really cute. All the animals were so sweet.
I came here for the, I don't know, pumpkin festival, the normal thing, but this is cool. It's a little low-key, but it's intimate, it's nice. Everyone gets to showcase what they have, and it's really cool.
Check your email, check the website, make sure you get the tickets, like, and just plan it beforehand. Yeah.
It's a fun date night. Do it. There's no reason not to do it. It's very nice. It's very like, it's the beginning of fall, beginning of October situation. It's such a great way to just kick the October season off. It's great.
It's important to note that all ticket sales from tonight's event will be going straight to help out the students from the Don B. Huntley College of Agriculture. And for those who couldn't make it to tonight's event, no worries. Cal Poly has you covered. For the next month of October, Cal Poly Pomona will be hosting its 30th annual Pumpkin Patch Festival. And for those looking for more information, make sure to check out the Cal Poly Pomona's website.
Get ready to see a splash of colors and a parade of flowers as CPP's Rose Float Club celebrates its 75th year in the Pasadena Tournament of Roses Parade with a presentation of Rock and Shock as this year's theme. The float will feature a 16-foot wide manta ray with electronic instruments being electrified by electric eels. And this year, our club is teaming up with Cal Poly San Luis Obispo for an electrifying collaboration. We can't wait to see the results.
Speaking of the fall season, I just remembered that it also means it's starting to become sweater weather again.
Yeah, that's so true. Our school gets so cold and windy sometimes walking to class in the morning.
But that's not the case for our men's soccer team, as they are staying hot on their feet and definitely not wearing any sweaters on the field. And David is there to tell us more on
PolyPost Sports.
Welcome to the fall season, Broncos. I'm your host, David Pendleton, and this is PolyPost Sports. Starting things off, Cal Poly's volleyball team has hit a bumpy road midway through the season, losing in a close battle at Cal State San Bernardino 2-3. This comes after the Broncos had their 10-game winning streak broken 2 days prior against San Francisco State, losing 0-3. Moving on to cross country, both the men's and women's teams took home the Pomona Pitzer title after a dominant performance all around. Ricardo Vargas led the men's cross country team, placing fourth in the field of 145 with a final time of 25 minutes and 2.8 seconds. Five other Broncos followed shortly after, placing 6th through 10th. The women's cross-country team came out with a similar performance when Alondra Arias finished 3rd against 122 runners with a time of 22 minutes and 25.6 seconds. Three other Broncos followed up in the top 10, finishing under 23 minutes. As for the Broncos soccer teams, both the men's and women's didn't disappoint. For the first time since 1999, the women's soccer team leads the league 4-0 to start out the season after defeating Stanislaus State 3-1 at home. Jacqueline Cuevas scored the Broncos' third goal of the game, making it her 7th of the season. The men's soccer team put on an impressive performance, burying Stanislaus State 8-0. The shutout game by Cal Poly puts them at 7-0-3, making history for the second time since 1983 to go unbeaten the first 10 games. That same weekend, the number 9 ranked Broncos battled against the number 3 in the nation, Chico State, which resulted in a 2-2 tie. Joining me today to talk more about the team is Sam Lina. He's a forward for Cal Poly's men's soccer team, earning last year's CCAA All-Academic Award and currently has 2 goals and 3 assists on the season. Sam, thanks for coming on.
Thank you.
In the beginning of the season, the men's soccer coaches of the CCAA division voted Cal Poly to be the favorite to win the CCAA title. What is it about this team that has coaches convinced that the Broncos could win it all?
A lot of it comes down to the quality of our players. We had 2 All-American players that came that we had last year, and they're also playing with us this year. One is a graduate student, and one is a senior, I believe. Mm-hmm. And we also have a lot of honorable mentions and past All-American players. And then also comes our style of play, very systematic, and it gets us a lot of chances that a lot of teams, I think, don't get. And we get usually we have the most amount of shots on goal than any other team. And the most amount of shots we released, the most amount of goals. So
yeah. Maybe why. Yeah, I know a lot of students are even looking forward to seeing this team come to playoffs. Now, according to the Santa Monica Daily Press, you've been playing soccer since you were 3 years old. And on top of playing in the 2021 CIF Finals, you've also played on the international stage at the Maccabi Games in Israel. Now, with all that experience, what has been the biggest takeaway playing at Cal Poly Pomona?
It was definitely a different level for me. Also physically, everyone was a lot bigger, faster, stronger. When I was younger, I was always used to being the fastest kid on every field I went to. Mm-hmm. And now I'm still one of the fastest, but other players have closed in. Mm-hmm. And so it just makes it more hard to get past individual players, hard on 1v1s. And then also, specifically here at CBP, there's a lot of information, especially in the first in preseason as a freshman. Mm-hmm. There's so much information that you have to know, and building relationships with your teammates on the field, knowing how to rotate in different positions, knowing your individual role as a winger is a lot more elaborate than it was at any other level I played at.
Yeah. Having 2 goals and 3 assists halfway through the season as a player may not seem like a lot to those who don't watch soccer, but can you briefly explain how difficult it is to score goals in college?
I mean, in the last game, we did score 8 goals.
Except for Santa's last day,
yeah.
Of course.
Yeah. But I mean, overall, like, I mean, we sometimes get like 20 shots on goal, but we only make like two of those. And so that like a tenth of a chance on every shot is a small percentage. Mm-hmm. And then especially against harder teams, those shots go down. And on very good defensive teams, it's very difficult. If they compact and just basically stay in front of their goal, it's hard to break them down. Mm-hmm. And so yeah, the goal count doesn't usually go much higher than like three goals per game, four goals per game.
Yeah, except for obviously.
Except for the last game.
That's such a great game. Both the men's and women's soccer team will face off against San Francisco State Friday, October 20th. Be sure to tune in. Sam, we wish you and your team the best of luck for the season, and thanks for coming on the broadcast.
Thank you for inviting me.
Yep. As for the women's volleyball team, they look to bounce back when they play at home against Cal Poly Humboldt on Friday, October 20th. The men's and women's cross-country teams will look to stay dominant in their performance at the CCAA Championships on Saturday, October 21st. That is all for Poly Post Sports today. Make sure to stay tuned for more Poly Post Sports content and keep up with all things Broncos sports at BroncosAthletics.com, where they stream games on the CCAA Network. But for now, this has been David Pendleton, and now back to the anchors.
Thanks for the recap on this week's sports, David. Looks like our opponents will need to brew up a spell if they want to beat our teams.
Sounds like you're a little too into the fall spirit and Halloween movies.
Maybe you're right. But that's all for today, Broncos. Tune in again next time with us here at Poly Post Now.
And don't forget to check out our website at thepolypost.com for more leading news content. But for now, this has been Diana.
And this is Alejandro.
Stay warm, Broncos.